Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The story of the temptation of Jesus is one of my favorites, I have to say. Ash Wednesday, the passage from Matthew that we had about, you know, not practicing piety in front of others is always kind of a difficult one for me every year. This one from the temptation story is one of my favorites, so I go from into one of my favorite stories. One of the things that's interesting about this story that we have in Luke, which appears in a very similar form in Matthew, and it just is basically one sentence in Mark and not at all in John. One of the things that's interesting about it is that it's just Jesus and the devil. So who was witnessing the story that they later told it and wrote it down in Scripture? Well, obviously, probably Jesus himself. In as much as Jesus had this experience, this amazing mystical encounter with temptation in the desert, and told his disciples, that is how we get this story in its present form. For both Matthew and Luke, it serves an important function. It allows them to round out the theological portrait of this Jesus person that they're setting up. So this is kind of the end of the introduction to Jesus and the beginning of the transition into his public ministry. It is a period of preparation for Jesus. Being anointed and being baptized was apparently not enough to equip him for the ministry he was about to go on. He needed this experience in the desert, wrestling with the demons. If you've ever read The Desert Fathers, who I just love to death, they were a group of men and women who decided to encounter God in themselves by going into a bleak place, northern Egypt, and they camped out in these caves. That's why they call them the Desert Fathers. And they began to try to understand Scripture and to understand God through this very aesthetic, hardcore kind of spirituality. And when you read their stories, which were passed down as the stories of the Desert Fathers, they're very brief little anecdotes. They're wonderful. They're kind of like Aesop's fables for Christians in the way. They often go something like this. Rabbi Poman said to Rabbi Abraham, I saw this devil and blah, blah, blah. There's always all these demons that appear. And what's important to recognize is that these men and women who were in this place experiencing these things, they were talking about these demons, and they were both metaphorical and not metaphorical in a way. Like, they were having genuine encounters with extremely difficult psychological, emotional, and physical things, which they chose to talk about in this kind of demon language. But if you've ever encountered the demonic in yourself or another person, you know that it has a kind of personality and it has selfhood. So there's a kind of integrity that it has. So it makes a lot of sense to speak about them as demons. One of the things to note right away in these demons that are presented to Jesus is that each of these temptations is in itself not a bad thing. For example, the first one, to make the stone become bread. Don't we want a God who feeds the hungry? Don't we want a Jesus who can restore the famished to fullness of belly and life? Isn't the temptation for Jesus to become such a Messiah figure, one who feeds the hungry, something that we can definitely agree with? Don't we pray that God would feed the hungry by turning the stones to bread? The second temptation, to take on worldly power. Imagine what good news that would be for the people of Israel under the occupation of the Romans, the people who have been yearning for freedom from oppression. Good news for our own people now around the world who long for justice and for freedom, political justice. Isn't that a good thing? Don't we want a God who brings freedom to the oppressed peoples of the world, who can bring peace through a new reign? Or how about that last temptation, throwing himself down from the pinnacle, and in so doing become a sign of hope for the people that God really does intervene to take care of his beloved? This is a God who can save you, can protect you, who will hold you in their hands lest you dash your foot against a stone. Isn't that the kind of Jesus that we want? And yet, Jesus rejects all of those temptations. He rejects the possibility of turning stone into bread to heal, feed the hungry. He rejects the possibility of taking on political authority in the kind of way that many had hoped that the Messiah would. And he also rejects the possibility of doing the spectacular sign that would cause all people to come and to believe in him and his anointed status. He rejects all those things. And yet here we are, 2,000 years later, still pushing for those very things that he seems to deny, still wanting to transform our unjust society and structures and to have influence in government and political process, still asking God to keep the hungry. still asking God to show us a sign that we might believe. I don't know about you, but I have from time to time prayed that God would intervene in a very specific way. And knowing that if God did that, that I would believe so much more, right? I'd have so much more faith if God just did this little thing for me. It's such a little thing. Alas, that is not the God we have. So why this distance between the God we want and the God we have? Well, that's a puzzle for the theologians. One way that problem is constructed is to use it as a way to talk about the incredible freedom that God gives us. That the reason that God doesn't just snap Jesus' fingers and cause all the hungry to be fed is because that would eliminate the possibility of us doing that work, of us choosing God. That we need a certain distance between what we want, what we are inspired to want even by the Holy Spirit, and what God grants us, because that's the space in which we operate, in which human freedom operates, and human agency. But to be honest, that answer doesn't always work, because there's lots and lots of examples where there's no possibility of us intervening. There's either because the problems are so huge, or just by their very nature, the way they're constructed, they're not things which human agency can solve. So why doesn't God jump in? Interestingly, Jesus does do these very things he's tempted to do, but not in the way that we expect. He does feed the hungry. How? Well, of course, there's the miracle story where he takes a little tiny piece of bread and breaks it and so on. But even more importantly, by becoming the very bread itself. The bread which is going to feed the world, nourishing hungers that were unexpressed for millennia. Or how about the way that Jesus' kingship comes to fruition. Not the kind of kingship we expected, one who would lead a military campaign to hurl the wicked Romans. Or even in our own era, a King Jesus that would lead us to take political power and to get the policies and changes that we think are right for society in place. Nope, this is a different kind of kingship. We proclaim a kingdom not of this world, and yet breaking into this world, overlapping in some strange and mystical way. We're called to citizenship in heaven, a place of justice, freedom, and peace. And that has implications for how we live now, and even how we're supposed to operate politically in our society. But it's still not a kingship like others would understand it. And then there's the pinnacle. In what way does Jesus fulfill that temptation in his flipped up upside down, Jesus-y kind of way? Well, it turns out that he is going to be lifted up on a pinnacle of sorts, the cross on the hill of Calvary. And through his very crucifixion will become that sign of hope that the world so desperately needed. The cross is medicine for the world. It's an old Latin motto that says that. The cross is medicine for the world. All who look upon him will be saved. It will be that sign. For those who believe, they will know life in Jesus. Not just a sign that they might see, that they might point to and say, look, God did something miraculous here. Although it is that, it's so much more. It's something which we are invited to participate in. So rather than watching a magician toss himself off a great height and land and not be hurt, we're the ones who are asked to go up and to bear our cross. So that we may become the signs for the world of the hope that God has in the resurrection. Now, as I commonly do, I'm going to open it up for reflections about the nature of temptation and these and how Jesus looks it up. But we'll end here. Does anyone have a good temptation story? Cameron, I know you've been tempted.
All the time. I was just thinking, sort of in similar directions to how you were reflecting on this. And it's like Jesus did feed, he is a leader, and he did overcome extreme danger in the end. And he
all through the data, right? And by continually reminding ourselves of those things, we basically conform our minds into the image of Christ, into the one of Christ.
So I'm just really struck in this passage with the sense of Jesus waiting on the Lord, like not making it happen, waiting for God's will to happen. I think maybe that's one of the challenges for us in Lent, is to just, no, we don't have all the solutions. We're waiting for God's guidance.
Yeah, the story that says, this is at the end of the 40 days, right? So he spent, he spent 40 days in the wilderness, and it's only at the end of that, and you're right, that's a long period of waiting. The thing about fasting, if you cannot go 40 days without water, but you can go about 40 days without food, and the implications are pretty extreme. One of the things that happens if you go that long without food is your body starts to eat itself through a process called mitosis. And one of the things that's particular is you get a very specific coppery taste in your mouth from the ketones, the chemical compounds, the breaking down of the protein in your body. So, and at that stage, like 40 days, one of the things that would be happening is even things like heart muscle and liver muscle, things like that, they're really important vital organs start to be consumed by the body itself. And you might just protect those, but you start to have some really serious consequences in your blood chemistry. You can get really messed up, things like that. So it's extremely dangerous. And so another thing that happens is because of the lack of glucose, blood sugar, your brain starts to also kind of shut down. And the way you notice it is you get really foggy, and you realize that you're not thinking as quick or as fast, and your recall isn't as good, and just your mental acuity really drops. So for Jesus to be in this state of kind of, on the plus side, you find the quietness of the body and mind through a fast like that that is really difficult to achieve otherwise. In other words, how do I describe it? It's like things just get very quiet in your body and in your mind, and the sense of time is different, like it starts to stretch out. You actually don't feel hungry. You sort of begin to see the edge of something like emptiness. So the waiting is really profound in that kind of state.
It occurs to me that there's actually a fourth temptation in the story, and it's the one that comes first when the devil insinuates, if you are the Son of God, which is really much the same temptation as the serpent said to Adam and Eve in the garden. Do you really believe that you shouldn't eat this fruit? After all, God knows that if you eat this fruit, you will be like God. In other words, do you trust God, or is God just using you? Underneath all the temptations is this deepest question, do you really trust God?
The thing that comes out is that Jesus' acquaintance with Scripture, he really knows his word. In other situations, I've been told that most of this comes from Deuteronomy, which he was probably studying. Oftentimes, God will bring something to my mind, and I'll be able to quote something from Scripture, which will mean the situation is turned around. And it's so necessary that we know Scripture. Jen said that we know the situation, but if we know Scripture, it really underlies the whole thing. And it's so important to know what is there in Scripture. And that's all I want to say.
That's a good one.
reach so far this morning in the leaflet, you know. It just takes us to this whole place of preparation to these temptations, right? I mean, while I was singing the praise hymn, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing," for example, that's the one that really caught my attention. And if you look at that and look at some of these words, look at what we're asking God to do, right? We're asking Him to tune our hearts to sing Your grace, right? Then further down, the one that really got to me was, "Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God," right? So He came to my rescue. He rescued me from the danger, and He interposed His precious blood, right? I mean, like, the last one again goes and says, "Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love." You know, I'm tempted to leave the God I love, right? So, Lord, take my heart, Lord, right? I'm also prone to wander, right? And then He said, "Take it, Lord. Take it and seal it. Seal it." You understand what I'm saying? So, like, I'm saying, when you have this type of, when you have this, like Monica said, when you have your equipment, when you are ready, when God has sealed your heart, you can go anywhere, you can face any temptation, because you know that you can. It's like being married. When you are married and you are deeply in love with your wife, man, you can go anywhere, anyhow, because she could be as beautiful as anything else. Your heart is sealed. You know what I'm saying? So Satan can come with whatever he has. He cannot penetrate that vault that you have got when God has protected your heart, my friend. So I tell you, seek ye first the kingdom of God right there, and you'll get that heart sealed up.
Audrey will love that.
I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about you.
The image of the heart being sealed appears in the Song of Solomon as one of the images in there. And the Song of Solomon is this great love poem. And the reason that it's in Scripture is because from earliest days, God's people always recognized in it a story not only of romantic love between two beings, but a kind of mystical love between God and humanity. And so that's why it's in the Bible, basically. And that it has that image of the heart being sealed. And I've always found that a very interesting image, because that's not normally something we talk about, you know, the heart being sealed. We talk about, you know, being open-hearted, things like that, but this is actually a different image. And I like how you talked about how, you know, sort of like, it's sufficient or something, you know,
it's a lockdown.
Lockdown, yeah. All right, there's actually maybe one more. Yeah, Sean.
I'd just like to say a couple of things. First, about the scripture, the devil here is, of course, quoting scripture as well as we've got the quote on the next to the gospel passage. But the devil is there kind of, I think, as a foreshadowing of the Pharisees. The Pharisees are Jesus' opponents in this sort of struggle over the interpretation of scripture. And it's actually, you can see how easily you yourself can slip into this sort of Pharisaical mode, as you pointed out in your sermon. These are the reason that they're temptations, because at some point they seem reasonable, right? And that's what makes them so dangerous. The second point, is to make it about will. So what you're talking about, will is very important, and conformity of will to the will of Christ and the will of God. Song of Songs, that's actually the dream that we had at our wedding, said Jesus to you on her. And it's an impression that it's pressed in very hard and permanent. And this is the word of God making an impression on our hearts as being set there permanently.
Seal, because I think you're right, it is a really cool thing. I only have like two or three documents in my life that have a seal on them. And, you know, two of them are my ordination certificates. And when the bishop does that, like at my ordination service, he did that as part of the service. And he licked his ring before pressing the wax. And I found out that's because he found out that if you don't do that, the little wax gets stuck in the ring. So it's a trick. They lick the ring and then they press it in. It's very cool.
That's also, you can also, symbolically, this is something that Jesus does all the time. It's very earthy. When he heals the blind man, he takes
the dirt. Pressing.